Hi guys, welcome back. This is Insomnia 56 Trucible Championships, and with me Noxious and Raven. We had 5 matches today, but I think that's the cherry on top, although it's still 4 matches further away during the day.
Yeah.
But it's Life Coach versus Colento. What do you think about that match, guys?
Yeah, it's going to be huge. I mean, like, it's two of the biggest names in Hearthstone from pretty much day one of the game coming out. Like, they were some of the biggest names, like, so early on. And the performances alone, I mean, Colento known as one of the best players in EU, although hasn't had too much in results super recently. And then on the flip side, obviously, your teammate Life Coach been performing really well. He's always been really good, but I think earlier on didn't get too many, like, actual first place finishes. Mm-hmm. But lately he's been putting out the results.
Yeah, and I really want to see what the period of adaptation will be for both players after League of Explorers is, you know, all finalized. Because I know Life Coach, we were talking about that, puts a lot of time into, you know, testing any archetype, any card that comes out in any archetype in the variants. And I feel like there might be too many of them to really, like, touch upon everything afterwards. And I want to see if his results get affected by that or not. Because overall, you know, Colento was one of the biggest players initially, like one of the most, you know, high performance ones. And somehow, of recent memory, Life Coach kind of took that spot for a while. Like, he's just been powering through tournaments. Well, and I've been pretty impressed with him.
It seems like Colento did just withdraw from competitive gaming in favor of streaming.
Absolutely.
Right? And he's consistently streaming with a lot of viewers. I think, like, this is something that took his majority of his focus, but at the same time, now we see him more often, so hopefully he will be again performing as well as he was in the previous tournaments. And from what I recall, the last match between those two players, between Life Coach and Colento, was happening during the WCA qualifiers in Cologne during Gamescom, and Nimsh was casting that, and from what I remember, Life Coach lost, although he was leading 2-0 against Colento. So Colento reverse swept him.
On his patron deck as well. So he lost 3 times with patron Life Coach. So that must hurt because he put a lot into that deck. So yeah, we are going to see Life Coach's lineup is Warrior, Druid, and Paladin versus Colento's Warlock, Rogue, and Paladin. So again, something we see more often is like a good mixture of classes. It's not like the same, oh, it's these 3 set classes, you know, for both players.
Right. We even saw Priest today.
Yeah.
We saw Priest from 2 players total. Trump ended up falling, but I think it's kind of funny the way that the lineups are displaying pretty much every single class at the moment. It feels like Mage is the one we've seen the least of, at least. Like, we've seen very, very little of it.
Yeah, that's true. Like, we don't see Mage at all. Or even if we see Mage as a deck in a hall, it's a tempo deck, right? It's an aggressive version. We don't see Freeze Mage. During the current meta game, like after inclusion of League of Explorers, it seems like practically Freeze Mage has gone obsolete, right? In the environment.
Well, Super JJ did really well at Seat Story, but his lineup was built around him playing Freeze Mage, and sometimes that doesn't apply because if the rest of the lineup doesn't match up against the current meta that well, then that's a bit, you know, that's going to cause.
Yeah, but that also was last year was standing with ban format.
Yeah. Oh, that's true.
You
yeah,
target a bit
ban,
more
right,
easily.
Yeah, when you can ban a certain strategies and just be more consistent with your type of thinking, right?
But match Paladin versus Rogue, though, so kind of already feel that Life Coach is on the sort of losing end of the pick phase, at least.
Well, I mean, it usually is the case that Rogue ends up winning against Paladin. I don't know what Life Coach brought specifically, though, as far as this Paladin goes. The equality makes me believe it's going to be more the mid-range style, but we've seen a Reno Paladin recently.
Oh, yeah, he has, hasn't he?
We have seen a Reno Paladin. I can't imagine it would be necessarily excellent, but Reno is known for one thing against Rogues, and that's completely shutting down their ability to kill you. Let's say you heal even from 15.
Yeah.
Just from 15, you've already taken away so much of their damage potential already.
Yeah, and the Rogue class is definitely one of those that has a very finite amount of damage it can put out in a turn, and even over the course of a couple of turns. So, yeah, it's definitely one way to lock it out. And this does look like mid-range, especially now, like we see the heal bot. Unless it could still be Murloc.
I believe in Reno.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not guaranteed, but again, it's something that we saw him play in Star Ladder recently. And even though it didn't do necessarily the best of all the decks that we saw, it seemed like it would be like a deck that Life Coach likes to play repeatedly. Reminds me a bit of that Control Paladin that we used to see him play back in the Naxxramas era.
Yeah.
And that was kind of the playstyle it had.
Yeah, so for now, Life Coach, as always, taking plenty of time on his turn to hero power. Where did I read this? Like I think he said that he takes the time, especially in the first two turns, just to get just to sit and think about the overall game plan of the match.
So it's not like
he's actually BMing or anything, or like wondering, oh, do I hero power or pass? It's like he's actually just utilizing the time he actually has.
Not only that, but also it's very important for him to get into the zone.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not about thinking how the match will go. I mean, he does that, but the reason why he does that is to be super focused on the game, forget about anything that can happen outside the game. If you have a problem at home, you don't want to think about that. This is why he is focusing. If you have like
That's deep. Yeah, it actually makes a lot of sense though. Yeah. It's the best way to get your mindset onto the game itself.
So far, the Zombie Child's gonna get cleared up with the SI, and what's the follow-up here? Oh, just dropping Farseer.
Yep.
That's really nice, actually. Just bring that SI back up to 3-3 and stop the token
trade. Wow, Harrison Jones will make a huge difference. I mean, it's a very difficult decision when to play Harrison Jones against a Rogue, because usually what the Rogue does is he uses his dagger in the same turn twice.
With Blade Flurry,
with
right
Blade
away.
Flurry. So you either use your Harrison Jones as soon as possible just to get that draw, the value out of it as soon as possible, as I said before. But the other way of thinking is you want to just wait for a dagger to be, I just want to bait out the dagger to use deadly poison on it so it will attack with the dagger and just set the dagger on a 3-1 and then use the Harrison Jones. But it's very tricky to make that setup. So it's a huge decision when to queue up that Harrison Jones.
It's hard to pressure the Rogue in exactly the way that you need to in order to force her to wait on that Blade Flurry.
Yeah.
Like, it's getting her to the point where she feels just threatened enough to hold it and try to deter you from playing anything is really tough.
Keeper Voodooman utilizes here the board and makes a really good trade for Life Coach, because the minion is a free fall, which allows him to trade with the Farseer next turn and still have decent board, right?
Yeah, definitely. And it looks like, double Violet Teacher in the deck as well from Kalento, so I like that. Violet Teacher, I guess, backstab and trade is going to be the play here, just to get the extra 1-1.
It's a bit awkward in that you're really not doing too much, and you can't really avoid doing it, because if you don't do it, then you're letting him get the kill on the Teacher with the 3-attack minion and, say, a weapon or even the Consecration later on. So you have to make the trade, even though it feels a little sub-optimized.
Yep. And he does have preparation into sprint as well, so that's going to be really nice to be able to just refill, because Anne's getting a little bit low for the Rogue there.
I don't dislike just True Silver setup, even. You could attack the Teacher, because you're basically telegraphing that you're trying to set up a Consecration, so there's a decent argument to maybe play it slower, play just the Shredder. That's a good play.
Yeah.
But if you want to go for True Silver, you're forcing him to slow down because you're telegraphing the Consecration. The only thing that shuts you out is a Lothar. And if that happens, you're in trouble.
Yep. And he's going to go for the Hero Power and Coghammer instead.
What do you think about that?
I would attack the Teacher if I do that, right? Just so I can finish it off with Consecration on the following turn, at the very least, or at least trade my weapon up for the True Silver and then finish it off.
But by the way, by doing this, he's actually baiting out also the dagger.
The dagger, yeah, forcing the dagger out, and possibly getting himself the draw if necessary. I doubt we'll see much Harrison coming up in the next turn, but it's forcing the Rogue to play suboptimally as far as mana efficiency.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a really big deal.
Yeah, that's a really huge deal, especially if Colento will have to sacrifice the board control just to get value out of his deck next turn, right? And this might be happening when he uses the preparation sprint, when Life Coach will take advantage of the Consecration and will still have a 1-1 minion on board.
You think he wants to Consecrate now, though? Because he can kill the 3-2 with the weapon, and although you never really want to leave minions on the board against the Rogue, it's just if you Consecrate, then he's just going to Hero Power this turn as well. So he'll be left with the 2-1 weapon and a 1-1 on the board, which just feels kind of... It's not slow versus the Rogue because he's cleared the board, but I don't know. I think this might be the turn where he could take a bit of a risk and just kill the Violet Teacher. And
Shredder
then drop
Hero
like Shredder
Power.
Hero Power, yeah. Because that feels you know, like the 1-1s, yeah, they can get, if they get the oil on them, for example, for some burst, well, you're probably not going to get burst down next turn from 27. So he might be able to just take the chance now.
The problem is if your opponent will be able to clear the board with Blade Flurry, an example, right? Then most likely will be also losing the drop from the feather.
It costs a lot though to play with Blade Flurry here, right? On turn six, it's literally, I mean, it's not the entire turn, but it is a pretty costly investment. I feel like no matter what play you make here, you're vulnerable to different sets of sets of plays. But the big issue with the one that plays it maybe a bit too slow by playing Consecration is if you do that turn later, then it's even more vulnerable to the same thing.
Yeah. Well, again, like if he did Consecrate this turn, then we'd just see Tomb Pillager Hero Power down the 1-1. Yeah. And then suddenly, well, you're in the same position as you were the turn before. You're behind on board.
I mean, so this is this Tomb Pillager. Yeah, we see it again, right?
Yeah.
Another player bringing it. It's really nice to see that the card is being played by multiple people. It's not one person, you know, freaky that thinks, oh yeah, this card is viable in All Rogue. No, Kalento decides that it's actually a good fit for his deck as well.
And it's vulnerable to Pilot Shredders, and we can actually see that now, right? It dies directly to the Pilot Shredder, gives the coin back, which allows Kalento to use Edwin Van Cleef with more efficiency, right? That's one of the reasons why Edwin Van Cleef is back into the deck.
Right.
But at the same time, is it worth it to have like the advantage of the coin instead of the minion?
Yeah, I mean, we were talking about that earlier, right? Like, what it does is it shifts the deck from being tempo-based, where Shredder gives you tempo immediately, whereas the coin gives you kind of a combo piece, as well as tempo down the line. Like, you're investing your tempo now, and you're getting it back in the form of a future play.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So. Now I wouldn't actually mind Consecrate now, because he has the board, and then you play the minion.
Then it was better to use to attack into the minion.
Into the minion,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah, true.
Consecrated, so in this situation, it's obvious that Lifegood's plan was including a different route, right? And the route was to just deploy the weapon to have the tempo advantage from the upcoming turns to use his life points as a resource, as an additional resource apart from his mana.
Deploy the life points. So this is a weird spot for Kalento, because on one end, Dr. Boom is available, and Dr. Boom, because it's available, is likely to be one of the options that you just want to take, because it puts pressure, and you're still able on turn 8 to develop your weapon, have the coin to guarantee that you can combo out anything you have to, and because you have minions already on the board established, you're also able to get a good oil flurry on the following turn. So it's kind of like the most tempo-heavy play, which is probably why Pilot of Shredder feels like a natural inclusion in the deck. You know, you're playing for tempo so hard that it's difficult sometimes to see a deck where you wouldn't include it.
Hmm. Now, is this just the quality Consecrate Creeper?
I'm not a big fan.
Yeah, the flip side is he doesn't need to, because he has the weapon now, so.
Yeah, I'd probably just go for Healbot Creeper. Attack with a 3-3 weapon and then Healbot yourself.
Yeah.
But it is a tricky turn. It's just that losing your board sweep that you can use in an emergency is pretty difficult.
Yeah. Isn't Dr. Boom an emergency? That's the question.
Dr. Boom on turn 7 is always
Dr. Boom actually is in the ER, but he's not the doctor there. He's actually the one beating people up. He's putting people in the ER.
A nice one. He's the George Clooney.
Nice joke, Knox. You're so dank. That was a decent play.
Well, he still has the access to the Consecration.
Right.
Which is very important against the second Violet Teacher that will come down at some point of the game. So it's an interesting choice of action, but I think it's very viable against that type of rogue, which practically has less sticky minions on board. So the Consecration has more value.
More value.
Yes. And it previously had.
Yeah. And also we have to consider, you know, what is Life Coach playing? Real Paladin earlier, but it's kind of difficult to evaluate at this stage.
Did he have?
We
didn't see any kind of duplicates, right?
We haven't seen a single card twice, but it doesn't mean much, right? Until you see the entire roster. But I mean, when you start seeing Creeper in something like looks like mid-range, you have to assume the deck is trying to split its curve a little bit.
When you see Creeper instead of Minibot,
right,
draw on you.
Yeah, in a bit of
I think Minibot's a little bit better.
Now the Advent Success will be a huge problem for Lifecode.
Well, he has the True Silver. I mean,
yeah, but he can't kill the Violet Teacher then.
Oh, okay, this must be Reno, right?
It is.
I know Life Coach likes this card in Paladin. It's something he's ran in the past. But at this stage, just gotta think it's Reno.
Yeah, no, it is. It is, I think, the exact list, or something close to the list that we saw at Starladder.
He's put Wrath Arm in it, I hope. That'd be amazing.
The Angel of Law hits the...
Oh!
Wait. Is it worth it?
Yeah. I mean...
You silence and kill the Violet Teacher?
Yeah.
I think so. I'd take that play. Or do you prefer to wait a turn? But that's a lot of damage for Oil.
Yeah.
You haven't seen anything. You're going on turn 9.
And he has the access still to one preparation. So it might be very, very... Well, he would use that preparation right now, right? After they call it. Just to have an even bigger...
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay.
So Lefka should know that there's no preparation, but there's still the threat of Blade Flurry.
I mean, do you pop your spider or do you play it for value by killing the 1/1?
Yeah,
that's, I think playing it for value is a bit better in this with case, because you still have Consecration, right?
Oh, it's going face for the weapon.
Wow, I was thinking about it that you just want to kill the 2/2.
Yeah, same.
Instead.
But I think if he's thinking, I'm going to play Consecration, why would I attack into it?
Yes, but this give is away, right?
Right.
Because maybe
it's interesting the way that he just doesn't mind revealing the info. He just tells Colento,
I
have the contract.
Here are my cards.
Right.
Well, he has the Lotep, right?
Yeah, that's
a huge deal against all Rogue in general. Mm. So if Colento goes for board control right now, I mean, he has to use that Fan of Knives, right?
It's a decent Fan of Knives, too.
Oh,
actually,
my
it's even
God.
Better now.
Backstab.
That hurts.
These draws.
So you use the Edwin Van Cleef remains, the silent remains of Edwin Van Cleef to kill the Haunted Creeper, and then backstab the Harrison Jones and assert dominance with Fan of Knives.
Fan of Knives, exactly. That's really painful if you're Life Coach. Does he have another Equality, another Consec? That's what we need to know, because those are the cards that would basically bring him back.
But if it's
like
Reno Paladin, you can't imagine that, right?
Well, I think we saw two Consecrations. Of all the cards that he plays, I think that might have been the only double, but I'm not 100% sure on that. Yeah.
Varian.
Doesn't feel good.
Yeah.
So the Consecration comes down, but it doesn't necessarily help that much. So would you favor to kill the Violet Teacher, even though it
kill
is
the Drake
anti-
and Lothab?
Yeah, well... Yeah, but there are two options, right? Because you can leave the Violet Teacher just to kind of screw up the Oil, right, on the upcoming turn.
Yeah, sure. That's one of the ways you can do. You can waste the play, basically. The thing is, Tyrion right now for Life Coach is going to be a last ditch effort if he ever plays it, because Sap is around.
Yeah.
Like that alone makes him not want to play Tyrion pretty much at any point. And the same is true of Sky Golem. It's a 6-mana investment, gets negated tempo-wise by 2 mana. So at any point where you play one of those guys, you're praying that nothing goes wrong.
Yeah, you need to really be playing 2 minions a turn or already have a board anyway, so that it's not the end of the world if you obviously Tyrion gets sapped, which you just got to presume, especially at this point in the game, pretty late on. We can see that he's only just drawn sap, but you know, you've got to presume your opponent has it this late.
Yeah, with his print having been played already. Now, Colento played the Tomb Pillager, played the second Drake, which means he's got a decent board and also a decent hand. Yeah.
It doesn't look good for Life Coach.
Not one bit. The amount of damage coming in just this turn is absolutely insane. Wow.
What
look at that.
Sap. 9 damage to the face.
Oil. But dagger up, oil, and then attack face, flurry.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, you kind of have to just clean this up.
Yeah, sounds good to me. I mean, you can even dagger, oil, eviscerate. So you can basically sap, you can eviscerate too, right?
No, because your dagger costs you two, and that's costing you a total of quite a bit of mana. Now, the question is whether or not Kalento wants to win right now, because keep in mind, Kalento knows this could be Reno Jackson. If I go all in now, a Reno comes out, do I have a follow-up? If the answer to that question is no, then do you really want to go all in? So if he slows down, it's definitely just because of that.
So he goes for the agent, just to finish off the low tip. Have a really difficult board to clean up.
Yeah, it's mildly annoying, to say the least.
The benefit here for Life Coach is that he's just seen... he didn't play Saps, sorry, no. So he's seen no Saps yet. This is horrendous.
Life Coach is even more worried now. Yeah. He's even more worried than he was a second ago.
Yeah, the Tyrion just doesn't make any sense right now.
Nothing makes
sense.
None of
his minions do, yeah.
Any card you play here is an over-investment.
Do you play Thorison to reduce Sky Golem to make it more likely to be able to play Sky Golem and something else next turn?
Why not? If you're going to play something, if you expect a sap, what's the Sky Golem going
to
do?
You just have to, right?
It's the only card that makes any sense here.
And I'm not exactly sure how many cards each player has left, but looking at Kalento's deck, it looks like not a lot.
Well, I think Kalento wins right now with the double eviscerate, like Dagger, Deadly, Oil, Eviscerate, the face. Well, actually, maybe you don't have enough for the Deadly. Technically, you could coin out something.
Well, just using...
I think he's got it, honestly. You don't even
need... Yeah, it is lethal. I was just wondering why do you not saying it's lethal.
Yeah, it's like way over. It's just that you have to get the Flurry in, and that's it.
Yep. Flurry finishes off the Paladin, which is not something that we didn't anticipate, right?
Yeah.
The Paladin is not that great against rogues in general. The problem is, Night Life Coach will have to, again, play against rogue, right? And he would have to, he would like to have the Paladin against other decks from Kalento, and he would not be able, he won't be able to use those, to use that Paladin anymore. So he needs to follow back on his Druid or Warrior.
Yeah, those are
finish up the match.
Like the Druid we talked about earlier, I think it's a little bit of a difficult matchup depending on how things go. But I don't know if Life Coach is playing a standard mid-range or if you went for something a bit different.
Mm-hmm. Well, he might be playing the Sir Finlay Druid. Right?
Why not?
It's a decent drop for a Druid.
And then on the flip side, if he has Warrior, then everyone's seen Life Coach play a lot of Patron Warrior. So,
also Control Warrior.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
He did pick it up. He switched to Patron at some point because he had to.
Yeah.
I remember that. I think he was one of the last people to finally say, all right, I'm going to sit down and take this deck seriously.
God, it's a fierce monkey.
Reno Jackson.
You think so?
Yeah, it's got to be.
Well, he was testing out Fierce Monkey before Reno Jackson came out.
Yeah, okay. I know Fierce Monkey is pretty good in Reno Warrior by a long shot. One of the most the most useful three drops in that deck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, of course.
There's very few cards that you would sub in instead.
I still remember the time when they announced the Spider Tank. Everyone was like, that's the end of the game.
It's power creep.
That's power creep. That's the end of the game.
Right.
3-4 for 3 mana, that's the end of the game. We can't even play nothing else than aggro.
Yeah.
What?
We all have to play, you know, mech decks, mech mage forever. That's all that we're ever going to see. And then all of a sudden, people started realizing, well, okay.
It's not that
big of a deal. Because the thing, it's kind of like when the 5 mana 5/6 came out. It was the next step, right?
Mm-hmm.
Expecting another curve vanilla card.
I think I have to disappoint you. Double execute.
Yeah.
That doesn't seem like a very Reno deck.
You do run two in Reno Warrior, though. In many lists, you end up running two executes. But he mulliganed one away, which, I mean, it's interesting. Like, he mulliganed one, got it back. I don't know if that means that he just got unlucky.
I mean, so far, other than the executes, everything is different. So, yeah. Difficult to confirm, but you'd have to go with, like, just standard Control Warrior, right? I say Life Coach Control Warrior with the monkey, because as you said, he was testing this card out before Reno came out. So
it's kind of like the Senjin, right? Like Senjin used to see some play in Warrior, and the good thing about the monkey is that instead of reacting to Shredder, you're killing it proactively, so that your Death's Bite on 4 is not competing with the Senjin.
That's true.
And Usain Deathbite on 4 just pretty much cleans up the Tomb Pillager pretty nicely. It's 5 damage, which is going to help because the Rogue needs to sort of keep the Warrior low to be, then be able to burst him down. But it looks like Life Coach is in a pretty good position so far.
Wow, Kalanta's hand is pretty cheap, even though there's a Dr. Boom in the hand.
Oh, it's even cheaper now.
Yep. Look at that. Well, I wonder if there will be a Harrison Jones.
Yeah.
I think there should be one, right?
I think so.
Oh, there's a slam. And probably that's a Arena Warlock deck.
I don't know. I remember, you know Black Wolf. I don't know. He used to work on like Crusher Shaman. Crusher and Black Wolf are pretty close. And the Reno Warrior that came out of Black Wolf was basically, like, the only double he had, I think, was executed in that deck.
Okay.
There was a crush as well, the top off the... Oh, never mind.
Yep, that's 2 Sludge Belchers.
Second okay. Belcher, chain of plans.
Because there was the Control Warrior very recently with, like, Slam and Bash
right.
as well. Mm-hmm. Just to, it went heavy control as opposed to, ran a couple of less minions, I think, and then just ran even more removal and just really played for the late game.
Okay. So now there are a few options for Life Coach. He can go for this early cycle with the slam. The question is, does he want to keep that for the 3 HP minions to combine that with the little slam or armor smith that he will play next this turn, right?
Sure.
Because he wants to use, of course, execute. And the question is, will he use the slam with conjunction with the execute and keep the weapon for a next
right.
That will be dropped?
Or use it now. Sure.
And just drop after that, drop the minions like Armor Smith. And, well, it doesn't make any sense with Armor Smith. Just
the
drop.
Belcher straight up, yeah, right? Yeah, second Belcher. And now, if there's a sap, it's not going to be enough. Like, whatever Kalento does here is going to have to clean up all those Belchers to even have a chance in this game.
Yeah, and just leaving no minions on the board is pretty big. And the Rogue sat on 16 with not the best hand in the world. The Tomb Pillager is not going to do anything quick enough. He can do some work with, say, the backstab on the other belt or this or something, but none of it feels great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, this is a terrible matchup when you think about it, right?
Rogue?
For Rogue.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's even worse when you don't have the access to Shadow Knight Stranders, and I think Kalanta doesn't play those. Because that's one of the minions that is, apart from Brawls, there's no way of removing that minion, right? So it's one way to ensure that you will have some output, some damage output for the turn when you have to oil. And that's one of the reasons why you can win against a Control Warrior, but in this situation...
With no board.
Yeah, no board, and your minions are not sticky at all. Like, the Pillager adds a coin, great stuff, for your to your hand when you don't need that against the Warrior at all.
Yep.
Yeah, it's one of the matchups that just... It's always difficult because they outreach your damage by just armoring up. But it's even worse when you don't have a good start. And I guess Shredder is, you know, we talked about the distinction between Pillager and Shredder. You know, say Shredder is sticky, whereas the Tomb Pillager is not. This is one of the matchups where you can feel the difference a lot.
Yeah.
You can feel it, like, literally in the way that the match plays out.
Especially that the coin is useless. Like, the coin doesn't necessarily give him anything.
You don't believe in the coin Deathwing?
Yeah, I don't believe in the coin Deathwing.
I think the only good thing for the coin is it can still proc combos. So he can even, like, if he needed to next turn, like, he could Phantom Knives as well, but just being able to have that extra option to coin into just, like, the oil, for example, just to get it out easily without having to commit other things if you want to keep hold of the Phantom Knives. But this is still looking pretty grim. I mean, it's just...
Armor Smith Sylvanas?
Yeah, I think at this point, sure.
You can keep the keep the Armor Smith and
armor up. Yeah, if you really want to be... You know, the play the Stensivka game where you just armor up as much as remotely possible.
But I think having up the armor smith is important if your opponent would like to have another take on having the board control, which is Violet Teacher, right? Because that allows you to clear one of those minions.
Well, that Drake doesn't want to get on this board.
Yep.
Don't send me out, please.
Not a good idea.
There's an evil lady over there.
There's a slam on Sylvanas into trade Farseer.
Yeah.
Just waiting around the corner to take advantage of the board. Ooh.
This is rough though, because now he's okay. So he's gonna do it this way, and just let the Sylvanas live.
Well, he's gonna get punished, but that's the plan. Yeah.
Yep.
Well, he has no other option.
Yeah, it's not as though killing the Sylve.
Yeah, I mean, he could have run the 3-3 in, and then Fan of Knives and take 5 to face, just to kill the Sylvanas, then play the Drake. But yeah, it still wouldn't have been great, but it would have at least cleared the Sylvanas off. And then the Drake would have been a bit...
Playing it super standard. Doesn't want to do any fancy Lothar plays.
Yeah, no value.
Are you disappointed?
I'm disappointed.
Okay.
And now there's almost no way for the Rogue to come back into this. I mean, this was looking pretty rough earlier on, but when you're facing down Sylvanas and Barangeddon on 6 health...
So, to be honest, the Death Spite in the hand was actually as lethal as the other means on board, so... Yeah.
Oh, wow, he can coin after prep. Oh, come on, Kalento.
No walls.
Yeah.
Well, it's 1-1, the Control Warrior. Fierce Monkey actually won a game, and now everyone will be running in the ladder.
So the trick is to play Fierce Monkey with its analog Silverback Patriarch to make sure that you're maxing out your primates.
Yeah, definitely. Just throw all the monkeys in there. Why not? And you could even include the new legendary to get the gold monkey.
Yeah, might as well.
Just to finish it off, why not? Yep, so what deck do you think Kalento's going to run into Life Coach with now? So Life Coach is with his control warrior. I think Kalento had Paladin and... what was his other
Druid, I think.
Druid,
right?
Okay.
I believe there's a Druid in Kalento's lineup.
Okay, so you'd imagine he picks the Druid into the warrior?
No, there was a Warlock.
Warlock.
Yeah,
Paladin,
right.
Yeah.
They had two different classes.
Okay, so it depends. Oh, yeah. So he's going to go for the Paladin, which seems more reasonable. Yep. So it is going to be the Warrior versus the Paladin matchup.
Yeah. Technically, I think if the Paladin gets a good, well, Kalento's playing. You know, we see Belcher Shredder. That indicates that it could be just about anything at this stage.
Yeah, but usually, it indicates nothing.
Right. But the thing is, sometimes when you see the Belcher, it means it's more of a mid-range deck. Okay. The juggler, though, you tend to see a little bit more in the secret paladin.
Yeah, in the secret paladin, so. Yeah.
Okay, sorry, guys, I had a slight.
It's okay. You were talking about monkeys, is all I heard.
Yeah, and then cut me off.
So there's like, I want to talk about monkeys. Not on my watch.
So is it the secret paladin?
I don't know yet.
The zombie chow makes me want to say... Maybe, but not likely. But the juggler
nice
makes
committal
me,
there, Noxus.
But the juggler makes me want to say more yes than no. But then the Belcher makes me want to say, I don't even know. Maybe it's Reno.
I mean, we have seen zombie chows and Belchers in Secret Paladin.
Yeah. Right.
So
a curve.
Which is very interesting, just to take an assumption that you can play such defensive creatures in an oppressive deck, right?
Oppressive. So. Oh, goodness. That's harsh.
An oppressive deck. There's that monkey again for turn 3, or potentially even coin from turn 2, but the Fiery War Axe is probably looking pretty nice right about now. Is there any reason not to coin the War Axe?
Yeah, if there's a mini bot, maybe you want to use the two charges, but at the same time, if you can't let Paladin be one turn ahead of you on board unless you're holding a brawl of sorts.
Yeah, because that's how they win, isn't
right.
it? The whole point here is, like, regardless of what deck it is, because of the minions that Paladin has access to, they can curve so well and so strong that they can just run away with the game that early.
Yeah, but if you play the Fear War Axe right now, you can't really count on your opponent overextending with a Knife Juggler, right?
Pretty much, yeah.
And then you would catch that Knife Juggler in the act, right, with the weapon.
Whoa, he does top deck minibot, though.
Ooh.
So do you have to commit the
Absolutely.
Yeah?
I mean, I feel like if there's a muster for battle, then... You're still able to use the Cruel Task somewhat effectively.
Yeah.
I mean, I say absolutely. I'm not Life Coach, so I don't know about him.
I always go for it.
Yeah, I think
always
you can afford to
it.
Take the damage,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And you want that over a mini-bot just sitting on the board. And then the thing is, if he does muster, then you do have Monkey as well.
Yeah, you have Monkey, you have Acolyte,
exactly,
you've got
yeah.
everything.
So you do have the answer. So I like this play from Life Coach. This is good.
You have to take the initiative. You let that Paladin do what he wants, and suddenly... Well, you stop asking questions.
Yeah, and now look at the turn. The muster isn't there. And, like, is he just going to blank Coghammer and kill off the 2-2? He probably has to.
Yeah. I mean, it's still a decent weapon.
Yeah.
It's not that bad. It's not that horrible, although you didn't get the biggest upside of the weapon, which is Divine Shield, which is perfect against Warriors in general because they have, like we just saw, right? The Warrior had to play suboptimally to kill the minion.
Yeah.
And that's the case always with a Divine Shield.
What's nice is forcing out the Coghammer now. Life Coach, if he wanted to, could have dropped the monkey. And if Kalenta would have been forced to then True Silver on top of that. You just lose so much durability on the weapon.
But do you, throw it away. Don't you want to make your opponent off cure?
Yeah, ideally. You want to make maybe force him to play True Silver on 5. Oh, that's a card the Life Coach is happy to see, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
That's your, oh, I don't know what to do now. Let's hit this button.
It's the emergency button.
Yeah.
And then the biggest minion on board lives.
Yeah.
That's how it works, at least for me.
It's always like that, and it's never mine.
Well, maybe that's because you use it when you don't have minions.
Well played.
Huh. Yay. That's the hungry toad.
No, is that the huge toad.
Huge toad. It began with a H. Come on, that was close.
The way
I was
works
actually
is
testing it in an aggro shaman.
It's actually good in aggro priest. I don't know about anywhere else.
Hunter, come on. It's a beast.
Yeah.
Wow, the Acolyte of Pain is going full aggro.
Feeling the pain.
Feel it.
Feel the pain. This huge toad looks to be pretty big very soon if Kalento wants to make it. But might as well just play on tempo if you want.
The okay. Camera has
just going to drop out. Oh, that's better, yeah.
Value. Yeah, it did a lot of work.
So for Lightcrest, feels like the next thing is just armor up, double shield slam. Oh.
What about just execute armor up? Nah. Oh god, this is actually kind of an annoying turn,
yeah.
But I feel like that may be a tiny bit better. Can you delay? I mean, at this point, if you're Life Coach, are you expecting Mysterious Challenger?
No, for sure not, right? Because there's no option that Mysterious Challenger wouldn't have been dropped this turn.
Yeah, there's no way that Belcher would have been played over it.
The only reason why you might not use the second Shield Slam and just use the Execute here is the fact that you have Shield Smite in the hand, so you can
next turn
something for 5. So an example, the Belcher.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was making the assumption to make the use of 2 Shield Slams just because he had the 1 Execute, but he topped the second one. So actually now it makes more sense probably just to use the Execute and the Shield Slam instead.
Yeah, and you Shield Slam the 5-2 and Execute the Toad, surely.
Yeah, of
that's
course.
That's the right play, right?
You Brawl.
Oh, wow, you Brawl. That's interesting.
And that's a decent outcome.
Yep, goes straight into the Execute. And just leave the 1-2 on the board, which is really nice. The only problem now is if Life Coach is only running 1, a lot of Control Warriors can run 2 as well, but if he's only running 1, then that's like pretty early Brawl there in terms of the late game.
Yeah, Kalento here with the Blessing of Kings on the slime. That Shield Slam's not going to kill.
Not going to be effective unless Shield Block will be drawn.
Right, that's actually going to be just enough damage to kill the slime.
Let's see what will be happening next turn. Competitive Spirit will also come down to
annoy.
Yeah.
Life Coach.
I know Life Coach. And, this is actually a huge problem for him.
Oh!
Wow!
Huge problem, you said. I love that. Spellbreaker, armor up, shield slam on the juggler, and suddenly the game's not the same
game. No, you first use the shield slam in case that's a venge.
Right. Yeah. To make sure that the slime removes, like, loses all the buffs.
That would be actually so sick if that would be a venge.
Yeah.
Imagine the value.
Yeah,
this the
value
guy's
was
getting.
Insane. It's still the slime is 2-3, but it lost the taunt.
And it doesn't trade with the 4-3.
Yeah. So. Oh, look at that. Now it trades.
Oh.
It's actually not that bad. Like the Master for Battle right now, it's an okay outcome
as well.
Right.
So.
All you have to do is top deck your quartermaster. You know, the one that's so
that
heavily played. Yeah, exactly.
Quartermaster, yeah.
Oh, that's awkward. Too bad it's not Baron Geddon.
Baron Geddon looks like a pretty good card to me in this spot.
Yeah, but there's no chance of drawing it. I mean, you can draw it, but you can't play it. So, what is your plan as a paladin here? Top deck a card, play it, right?
I think at this point, the amount of decisions are reduced to 1. Possibly 2 if you decide to consecrate alongside it. But yeah, that's about it. And now, Life Coach can hold on to his removal until it's necessary.
Mm-hmm. I guess along as the match progress, there will be more options to armor up, not only use the Shield Maiden, so he's not relying on the Shield Maiden to just make a huge Shield Slam anyway.
Yeah.
At this point, right? He used 1 Armorsmith, but he didn't see any Shield Block, and he didn't see any Bashes.
Mm. Yeah, we saw Slam. Like, we saw here the second Slam, right?
Right.
That's the second. So basically, what that means is Life Coach is running the bash, like no bash, and two slams, which gives us a bit of information as to what he's opting for. And I think that's what happened with a lot of players who prefer to play the double slam because it's cheaper and easier to weave in. Kalento here using the Consecration as a one damage to kill the Spellbreaker, and also making sure that he gets the maximum amount of damage per turn in the future.
Yeah, and also it means that without a weapon, the 5-3 is probably going to kill a 1-1 off, and then the Avenge is fairly safe, or as safe as it can be anyway. So it's going to require a weapon or an Execute or a Shield Slam to actually kill.
Well, from Life Coach perspective, it's not looking that great, to be honest.
It's almost good enough. But the moment
it's
a big
not
minion...
Yet.
Right.
Not yet.
Once a big minion falls down from Kalento, then things start to get really ugly for Life Coach.
I'm kind of surprised that he didn't attack into a minion, because I was thinking about slamming the Avenge minion now.
But the thing is, if it's Redemption or Noble Sack, I mean, Noble Sack you trigger by attacking, but if it's Redemption, you're doing nothing besides damage.
Oh, that's an awkward draw, look at that.
Yep.
That was actually the only, that's the only unusable card right now in his arsenal, in his whole deck. That's the only card that he can't use.
Yeah, even Muster is slightly better. You wouldn't have played it, but it is slightly better. Oh!
Ooh. So, you might think about slamming an Acolyte first. What do you think about that?
The question
your plan is,
do you plan to use your spells to kill what gets avenged? Or do you plan to use your Shield Maiden to kill what gets
I think you sacrifice the Shield Maiden, right?
Well, that's the question, really. That's what the decision is hinging on, is what he does.
Otherwise, you need two spells to actually kill it, right?
Yeah, and
two spells might be too much when it's Shield Slam and Execute has to be one of them.
You have to have a plan still against a Tyrion. In case a Tyrion drops, in case a Dr. Boom drops, right? This is how you have to think about it.
Oh!
But it's still not that helpful.
Right.
Oh, he still might lose.
But it is a great card, though. It is a great. It makes the rest of the game look a lot less grim for Life Coach, no matter how you put this.
Yeah. So, but now he has to use the Shield Slam. If he made the commitment with the bash.
Sure, that's fine, too.
With a removal on that Avenged minion.
Yeah. And next turn, he can Hero Power, just the car Hero Power, which always feels good.
Ooh, the draws for Kalento are not really pleasing him.
Has he forgot to put Mysterious Challenger in the deck?
I think so.
That would be hilarious if someone brings a Secret Palette into a tournament and it's like, oh, damn, I forgot to put
Challenger. When you build that deck, right? Like, you build the deck for ladder, and then you go on it, and you realize very, very far down the road that those two extra slots that you found to put whatever card it was, like Shades, you're like, oh yeah, I found two slots for Shades. Oh, but
well,
I didn't
know last I series, Sol actually played Tempo Mage. He had a Mad Scientist in the deck and no secrets. And he had to, because you submit the deck list, he had to lock that in and that was it. He did actually qualify though, so that's something to be said about that, but that's kind of funny. He only realized like three sets in, I think.
It says more about Tempo Mage than it does about...
yeah.
Well, it's still decent, right? A 2-2 creature, yep. It's okay.
Why not?
I mean, if there will be an Undertaker in the deck, still okay.
Gotta get that buff on the Undertaker.
Oh my god, I already forgot about the Undertaker. Like...
What, as a card?
As a card.
It exists.
Yeah, well... That was like best 3 months of Hearthstone ever.
I never...
Undertaker Hunter.
And the fact that Scarlet Purifier and the Little Exorcist were built to compete with it is just delusion.
The main issue with those cards is they didn't deal with Undertaker.
No.
They dealt with the Death Rattles. So it's like, yeah, we're going to, you know, build something...
Deal with the Death Rattles, deal the damage to the egg.
And even if you dealt with Undertaker, the Death Rattles is still out there.
Yeah.
They're coming for you. All right. Yeah. That should be, I think... The card that allows Life Coach from here on out to just casually walk all over Kalento.
Yeah. I was just going to say, does Mysterious Challenger top deck actually draw him back in? I'm not sure. Not with BGH. He can just choose to attack in, and no matter what the Avenge goes on. Oh, no, he's used both Avenge.
Yeah, he's used two
Avenges. No Avenge.
So all that can happen here is the Noble Sack, Redemption, Repentance, perhaps, if he's playing that
with
Competitive Spirit.
If he's playing Repentance, he can just play Sylvanas and then slam his Sylvanas to steal one of the minions anyway.
Yeah, why not? Might as well steal that 6-6 over there.
Yeah.
It's pretty good looking.
And can still tank up.
Gain 4 health, kill his, like, steal his 6-6. Please.
So there's just 2 secrets on Kalento's side.
Noble Sack, Redemption,
yep,
is my assumption.
Yeah, we saw the Competitive Spirit earlier.
Right. So if there's only one of those, we're not seeing any more. And the Defender gets down for the Acolyte.
Oh. Dr. Boom's a decent card, I guess.
And the Redemption.
Yeah, that was no more Avengers, so... And no Competitive Spirit, so the Big Game Hunter actually has no value.
No value.
Right?
At this point, it's only good against Dr. Boom, perhaps, at some point. But right now, it's not even going to be relevant. Because even if there is a Dr. Boom, you still take the game on the following turn, almost no matter what.
Yeah, I think this matchup overall was an uphill climb for Kalento. His draws quickly faded into not a lot. With the Avenge top deck into Avenge the following turn, just being able to hero power is going to be pretty rough against a deck that wants to just grind down and answer any big threats. And without Kalento really playing any big threats, except for the Mysterious Challenger right at the end, it was just too little too late.
Yeah, I feel like the start from Life Coach, you know, having the War Axe to deal with that zombie Chao early, and then followed with a mini bot using the Cruel Task.
Yeah.
The fact that he could actually curve responses as opposed to being one turn behind, which is always the case as a warrior. When you're one turn behind, you always end up falling way too far behind before you can get a good brawl. And if you don't have that brawl, then the game's over. But we see Kalento with a Warlock, we see a Dark Iron Dwarf. I kid you not, we are back in 2013.
Original Zoo with Peddler.
Well, the Peddler seems like one of the cards that will not go away from any version of
Warlock ever.
Yeah, right?
I can't even see a world in which I don't play that as a Warlock.
It's a great card. It's like a mad scientist.
Yeah.
Something among those lines.
Actually,
right?
That's right. It's up there. Possibly better, because you would play Bran, but I wouldn't play Baron Riven there.
So, what do you keep here? Because Life Coach won't know what Warlock this is, and there's so many variations. We've seen people bring the Reno Lock. Recently in tournaments such as DreamHack, we've seen Malilock perform really well. Obviously, there's a lot of people in the qualifier yesterday played Zoo. They may well
have changed the deck. This could be Reno.
Yeah, this could be Reno.
Like, we don't know anything about the entire list, and Dark Iron Dwarf might indicate that Clento's trying to spread around the cards. So there's a chance that this is just a Reno Lock with a very early game opener.
Yeah.
It happens before. And see, this is kind of the situation we brought up a long time ago, which is, do you ever not coin Peddler? And the answer to that is basically no, never, because you always tap on two.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Pretty much.
Yeah. And it also changes a lot when it comes to game plan if you have the card already in your hand, right?
Right.
Because it's a one mana card, so if you have like a Zombie Chao, you might not even tap if you play against aggressive decks, because that would be a Mortal Coil, an example.
Yeah. Yeah.
You want to fit the curve out the Zombie Chao, or just another drop that you have it in hand. An example here, the Abusive Surgeon looks like a great play, right? You just kill the Armor Smith, you still have 2 minions on board, your opponent is kind of in an awkward position when he has to use the weapon to kill those minions, to kill both minions when he lost already one card to one of those. Well, the Acolyte Fane, of course, it's an answer too, but I don't see a world where probably wouldn't want not want to trade the Armor Smith. Well, according to the segment.
Yep.
Well, Fiery War Axe is basically the like Life Coach's saving grace. I mean, I guess he's going to play the Acolyte here because he's got Death's Bite coming right up. And there's no reason to start playing a weapon now if you're not going to use all the charges on it in the end, especially this early in the game. But what this allows him to do is guarantee that he can draw cards, hopefully more than one, with his Acolyte. Unfortunately, we know that Kalento's holding Power Overwhelming from the Peddler as well as the Abusive. So he's basically, he's able to clean up the board if he wants next turn.
Yeah, the bonus here is that the if he sort of, he needs Power Overwhelming to proc that egg this turn. Mm-hmm. Just an Abusive Sergeant wouldn't be able to actually kill itself to create the 4-4. So we know it's going to, you know, delay one more turn. And as he said, hopefully get 2 cards out of the Acolyte, which we see is probably going to happen if he chooses to trade that way. I guess you just power overwhelm it into the Armorsmith, right?
Yeah, I mean, this power, like this Direwolf Alpha is surprisingly useful, because in many cases here, what you would do is you would use the Abusive. So that's a lot less impactful than having the Direwolf Alpha for the following turn. So I...
Especially when it also adds one damage.
Right, for the following...
To the Nerubian, right?
Yeah.
Lifecoach needs to deal with that, and the weapon is a great way to deal with that, but he needs that one additional damage to take.
Yeah, as much as it looks like Kalento's taking and seizing that early game, the Brawl, the Belcher, the Sylvanas, the Shield Slam, that's a lot of answers to Zeus' future threats. It's just about not getting pushed off the board too much.
Yeah. And the Deathbite's going to help with that. He's going to take the 5 damage, but then what he leaves on board isn't too threatening, and as you said, when he's got the follow-up, he should be okay for now.
Yeah. I expect Kalento maybe to try to save... Like, if the Deathbite gets played now, I expect Kalento to try to save his Peddler by Defend of Argusing, but I'm sure there's a world in which Lifecoach simply waits to Brawl, right? Simply goes Fiery War Axe, kill the Wolf, armor up, and then maybe lets Kalento overextend, and if that's not done, then he just Belchers, and then he still has the ball in the back end.
Well, he kills the Wolf.
Yeah.
Basically, what he achieves by that is he decreases the amount of attack for 2 next turn, right? I mean, yeah, actually, it's by 2.
It does, yeah. Exactly, because you reduce the damage, and you're setting up another AoE. Like, I mentioned the Fiery War Axe armor up. It saved, you know, a lot of HP over a long time, but the thing is it gave you less tempo because you eventually had to replay the Deathbite at some point in the future, whereas now he's got it already set up and he's not low enough on health. So this play is better than the War Axe for sure, but the idea of just holding on to your weapon and threatening your opponent from maybe overextending.
So Kalento has a few options now. None of them feel great. Do you think the Argus is actually worthwhile just to keep the minions on the board?
Well, what it does is it means your Nerubian will hit for 5 now, and also if Lifecoach uses the weapon again to smash into it, the Nerubian basically deals a total of 10 right away. So instead of dealing something like 8, it'll deal more than that.
Yep.
And if he wants to execute it to trigger...
He could gang boss as well and follow up with Argus the following turn, but this is a bit more mana efficient.
I was going to say, the other way he could play this is force Lifecoach to use an execute in the 4-4, which is kind of what's going on here.
Okay, well, this is the turn when probably Lifecoach just drops the Belcher, right, and pushes into a Brawl for the next turn.
Oh, yeah. Got to dodge the Owl, but yes, I think so.
The problem is, like, as you said, the Owl is a huge amount of damage. Mm-hmm. APO also solves the problem and doesn't necessarily push
into
overextending.
Even a boring Doomguard is a problem.
Well, if he plays the Doomguard, so he's overextending.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's not a problem, because then you Brawl, and you probably deal with the minion that's being left on the board. But the Peon right now, that's the problem. Because the minions that will be played after... Oh, look at that.
Well, I mean, Abusive Sergeant solves your problem partially. Like, you could even just Abusive, trade with the Peddler, and you're still good to go, right?
Mm-hmm. One of the strategies I like when you're playing Zoo is to tap as much as possible. You're not playing into the Doomguard as soon, right?
Sure.
As soon as you would in other matchups. But you want to have every single time you want to have a threat. So if
you're always
warrior,
threatening with the big hand, yeah.
If the warrior is just clearing the board, you just put another minion. And this can be only achievable if you try to life tap almost every single turn. So you might even tap on turn 2, or just cure out with a 1 mana minion on turn 3 and just tap. And
It slows down the aggression, but you play like mid range at that stage. Yeah. And when you play like mid range, you win against decks that are trying to outvalue you with a crazy, a sequence of board sweeps, and you don't need your health very early. So might as well just get it out of the way and be able to refill the board constantly.
Yep, exactly.
The options you get too, right? Like you get to choose what you refill the board with, and when you're able to refill it with sticky minions one after the other, that's way too many board clears.
Yeah, it's just going to add up, isn't it, and snowball out of control later on.
So now it's 8-9 damage on board, and I wonder, will Lifecoach be greedy? Will Lifecoach attack into the 4-4 and just play the Sylvanas?
Honestly, when you see the Peddler, because the first power overwhelming was acquired from Peddler. Having seen that, you know there's still another one or two, like two in the deck.
Yeah, yeah.
So just based on that knowledge, I think you're scared of being greedy. Unless he didn't spot that it was from Peddler, but I doubt it. He must have seen it.
Yeah, of course. Like,
you can sure check as well. People.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, some people sometimes, like, secrets are tough because they don't tell you they're from the let's say Ethereal Conjurer.
Yeah.
Until they're flipped. So sometimes it passes by and you don't really pay attention. So if Life Coach did pay attention, then being greedy is going to really
from Life Coach's perspective, do you like the Brawl or would you play greedy here? From Life Coach's knowledge.
Honestly, if I do anything, it's going to be like popping the spider if I play greedy and I refuse to brawl. Because you're still removing most of the threats.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, that setup's a clear for next turn with almost anything that happens on the board apart from a Doom Guard.
Yeah. It's just a really heavy use of Shield Slam. Like, it didn't feel that great. Which is the only thing that the Life Coach probably... That's why you might have been considering brawling, for sure. It just feels kind of awkward to use your Shield Slam to pop a spider.
What do you think about the Brawl right now? If the Defender of Argo lives, that's a great Brawl. Otherwise...
Armorsmith Brawl. The Armorsmith always wins.
This used to be the case, but somehow, of recent memory, it doesn't hold as much.
It's 6 damage on board, so if Dr. Boom is being played on board, that means GG. Lento wins.
Yeah.
9 damage from hand. 9, 11, 13, 15 damage. But it's still not over. Colento will have to play with his zoo against a druid, which favors him.
Technically, but yeah.
Unless Life Coach is playing a aggro druid, but I wouldn't count on doing that.
I don't count on Life Coach playing anything aggro.
It says aggro in it at all.
Temple Mage is the most that I've seen him play. That was like the most aggressive deck that I've ever seen Life Coach play was a Mech Mage. And literally, that's it.
Well, he was playing also a zoo.
For a while? Was it more of a mid-range zoo?
No, it was like
demon zoo?
The kind of obvious zoo.
The obvious zoo?
Yeah.
Obvious.
You start playing Hearthstone, you're like, what could I build? Well, cheap minions, I guess, we'll put them together.
Yeah, the obvious green ramp zoo.
All right. I haven't seen Life Coach play too much of that, so...
I think there was like a point in ATOC where he switched out the handlock just to surprise an enemy, and that was like one of the reasons.
Did he win?
I can't remember.
Oh, that's key. It's like, I'm gonna mind game. Oh no, I just lost.
Well, I remember it surprised people. Now that you mention it, I remember making the comment that switching up to the zoo was to surprise people, but I don't remember the result of that. I mean, they did end up winning, so it must have been fine. It must have done just
well,
fine.
Well, the aggro shaman back then wasn't really doing
goodness,
that
great. Oh my god.
It was lacking something. It might be the Murloc, it might have been the...
Trog.
The Trog, yeah.
Yeah. It might have been the problem with having two lava bursts every single time in the opening hand.
It might have been the lack of elemental destruction.
Well, to be honest, I did see first time elemental destruction today in Shaman.
So. I thought there were a few people playing it on ladder at High Legend, but it is a good fit for the deck. I mean, when you think about it, people play... You always complain as a shaman who's playing mech or aggro, I have to go all in because I have zero way to stabilize the board. And then you're like, oh, well maybe I can just play the most useless spell in the game for most situations, but in this
Except this case,
it works. Because I don't expect to curve with anything else afterwards.
Well, there's wild growth, but otherwise the hand doesn't look very appealing for Life Coach. He needs the Keeper of the Grove. He needs a Shredder, he needs a Darnassus Aspirant. That would be the greatest drop, I guess, because you can coin out Darnassus into Wildgrove.
Alright, so Colento's gonna go with the obvious, you know, let's push as much damage as possible play, which is proper against Druid. There's no reason to let them, you know, trying to milk an extra 2 damage from Abusive is only good if you're going to kill something with it.
Yeah, and I think in a lot of matchups is the zoo as well, and in most aggro decks, if you draw the Abusive and you have nothing else, it's almost always better to just put the pressure on the board. Because if it attacks once, then it's done the 2 damage anyway, and then if it can attack again, well, you've made that up and actually curved out instead of just past turn 1.
I guess this is the turn where Life Coach will Hero Power and kill the Abusive Surgeon, right?
I think so, to mitigate the damage, and then you can always Wild Growth as a follow-up.
Yeah.
He might... I don't expect him to cycle Wrath ever in a spot like this.
Not against Zul.
Yeah, yeah, you need so many three minions. Damage is worth quite a lot as well.
He's thinking about Wildgrove instead of hero powering. It's very interesting.
I think the idea is, though, if he hero powers now, that's one more turn he's got to wait to Wildgrove, and he needs to get up to these big minions quick. Unless he has to rely on a top deck of, say, Shredder or Keeper of the Grove just to be able to play something the next three turns.
Oh!
Hey, Reno!
Do you hero power kill the 2-1, then play Finley?
I think so.
Unless you get guaranteeing that mage hero power.
I keep calling Reno because I love the card, but...
Yeah, this is not a Reno deck.
Fino, oh wow. Finley on its own is such a good card.
The love child of Finley and Reno.
Well, I mean, if you fit one, might as well fit the other. Put all the explorers in the same deck. But I feel like Finley is good. Like, there's a few classes in which it's always pretty much better than the basic hero power. And I think Druid is one of those. The hero power of Druid is in between. It's always been that that problem that holds them back sometimes from getting clean turns. Is my hero power is half as good as other classes.
Well, this is...
Well, this is an awkward situation.
Yeah, none of these are actually too great versus...
Get the weapon.
And the thing about it, it's not that bad. It
might
buy you some
save two mana, right?
Yeah.
Every turn.
Yeah.
You lose the armor, but you can wait a turn.
Yeah.
Oh, the druid got the wizard's hat.
I put on my robe and a wizard's hat. And I play Malfurion. And I just wonder, though, if... Like, what is the best hero power you can get? Priest? It almost looks as though Priest would have to be somewhere near the top for druid. If you can keep your stuff alive...
Yeah, you're normally playing the bigger minions, so if you can keep trading, keep buffing them up.
Shaman, perhaps? I don't know.
Yeah.
Shaman's kind of awkward, but...
Surely the Shaman hero power is never the hero power to
pick. Well, Savage Roar!
Oh.
Have you not seen what it does?
I'm still thinking about the Rav. Was it that necessarily?
Yeah, I was
that necessary?
I think he's really desperately looking to curve at some point in the next 17 turns. And just finding it one card that could help with that.
So here is Colento just playing it to die, right? His life code would like to use it. Would like to use the hero power and the attack from the Finlay just to kill the knife juggler. The problem is, if he wants to curve out, he would like have to use the swipe, but it makes no sense.
Yeah, swipe, you'd leave 2 1-1s on the board.
Yeah.
Unless you want to swipe and then not hit the creeper,
yeah,
and let the creeper go into Finley, or you know, either or just not do anything at all.
Yeah. Well, otherwise I would just go for the ping and sacrifice the Finley.
Could you ever leave the juggler alive? Like you
and
just ping
what?
It.
What about Savage Roar to kill both?
Savage Roar on 5 is a bit better because you weave in the hero power, but yeah, I think that's one of the plays.
I think you just like go for the Savage Roar, kill Knife Juggler, kill Hunted Creeper, so you have a way of clearing the 1-1s next turn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I like that, actually.
It's only bad, and not even that bad, against Argus, but even then, it's not as though you have alternatives. I like the Savage Roar, it's like an okay play. But it's just very mana inefficient.
It is, but the same goes for the hero power.
Right.
And you don't set up a good swipe next turn. And that's a problem.
Yeah, whereas now if you'd made the play, like swiping, if the Darkhand Dwarf comes down, the swipe would have been amazing.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah,
but maybe
I'm sure that Colento
actually play straight into a swipe like that.
Exactly, Colento wouldn't have
Colento's
played
good
that.
At the game, right?
Yeah, he's decent.
He's okay.
Oh, that was one turn today.
He finally got...
Colento sees the Shredder fall immediately. He's like, yeah, he had absolutely nothing else ever. Not even a close to playable card.
Wow, the implosion.
Wow. The owl with abusive...
Yeah.
Wouldn't you like to play the implosion? I mean, it's before swipe,
right.
So...
Yeah, if you're going to play around swipe one turn, then surely you play around it the next turn.
Yeah.
Because it's not like... Oh, well, he didn't
and
swipe, so he's not got
well.
It. This wasn't a swipeable board, so...
Yeah.
So he could...
Life tap. This allows you to life tap if you really want to. So, I mean, owl, I think I... Would you lose the wolf? Like, owl, abusive the wolf, and play the Voidwalker? Or tap, pick one. is losing the owl.
You'll probably get away with the tap because there'll be nothing on board, so the Voidwalker is very easy to drop in
right.
any turn because it's only the one mana, so it'd be easier to just drop it in like after seeing Druid of the Claw or something that's actually going to have an immediate impact.
Wow.
You
okay.
actually went for the implosion. I'm really surprised.
Kind of weird because he played around Swipe the previous turn.
Well, he still kind of is, but not to the. I mean, he still keeps the key. The. How's it called? The Hunter Creeper, right?
Yeah, but.
No matter what. Like, the 1/1s will be alive. And you can then trade into that Snow Chugger if necessary.
I feel like the 1/1s, there will be no 1/1s because the Swipe will just kill the Dire Wolf. And then the Snow Chugger will just attack into the.
So you'll ping the spider afterwards? There will be.
No, we just don't ping the spider at all. Just leave it.
You could just leave it, yeah.
Oh, sure.
Or. Now, you have to kill the Dire Wolf. So the other option is to use Keeper and Hero Power.
I like that. I think that might be slightly better.
But then your Snow Chugger will die to the Imps because I'm sure that Colenta will sacrifice those.
Are you going
to
get a much better swipe than this? Because as the game goes on, you've just got to presume the more mid-range minions are going to come in. So this is a nice swipe just to deal with so many 1/1s there that, you know, power overwhelmings, the abusives are going to, like, there's going to be so much value.
And now Colenta can attack with his hero.
That's really unfortunate considering the amount of Blinktrons we've been seeing lying around these days.
More importantly now, next turn, Life Coach can actually play another minion. That could well be Dr. Boom.
It will probably be a Dr. Boom, right?
Yeah, you're under no pressure.
The better question is, when is it not?
For Colenta's an easy turn, that's Egg and Dark Iron Dwarf.
That's the only the only question he's got now is, do I egg, do I tap? And if you want to get aboard and scare the druid, the egg is obviously a tiny bit more more threatening.
But he, Life Coach has the keeper if Colenta wouldn't proc the bombs on his own terms. Because that's the problem. If the bombs hit the egg and proc that, then the keeper loses its value. I mean, loses half of the value because it's unable to deal to damage.
Goodness.
Oh, wow. How much damage is that? 9, 6, 11, 13 damage. That's a lot.
So, trade.
You trade? I don't think so.
I mean, if you trade your Dark Iron Dwarf and a 1/1 into the Dr. Boom, then use the 1/1 to kill the Boombot. You can then play Doomguard just to go face as a 5/7. Is it that bad? I mean, if the egg pops, it's just a bonus at that stage. Oh, you could even pop your egg instead of attacking and buffing the Dark Iron. I just figured it was decent protection against the Boombots.
But it's not guaranteed.
Like, right.
That's a problem.
Yeah.
It's like 50-50 to go there. A little less than that, slightly, but it's like in the 40% range. If you lose everything. Here we go.
No.
Oh.
And no pop for the egg, but.
You can abuse it.
Yeah, exactly.
Boombot now.
Hopefully for him, things won't go absolutely wrong. Making that trade, keeping himself the 4/4s instead.
That's interesting. So now for Life Coach, what are the options?
The options are hope the Boombot does what it has to.
Yeah.
For the like the first part of this is probably that.
And the problem as well is you've got the choice of you can ping one of the one.
I like the double shape ping. I love it. Yeah.
Oh. Okay. That's a huge deal.
Wow.
Is that Boombot justice?
This is Boombot justice for everything that happened to him prior to this.
So double shades. That's too slow.
Are
might
they?
Be too slow.
Well, you could play just the Emperor and ping. I just, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's okay, actually. The Warlock's on no cards, so you're not really expecting, like, Burst to come out of nowhere. Not in the 16 damage
So why wouldn't you just play double shades into ping? So
I like the double shade because if you find a Force of Nature, then suddenly you're dealing a lot of damage.
That's lethal.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
No, sorry, it's not. It's 28, right?
You're going to be...
25?
Yeah, he's at 25. He's going to be a little shy, I think. Because he's going up to 24 damage with that play.
But Colenta will tap.
That's true. Clint almost has to tap, right?
Yeah. I'm sure he has to tap. So the force of nature draw will have been lethal. Of course, that's like a 2 to 18, something like that, chance to draw it. So it wasn't that kind of obvious. But at the same time, you're playing around a lot of stuff that are targeting your minions, right? And you have two minions that will grow and just can kill that spider anyway. I'm not sure, like, it's okay.
Yeah. I suppose that with playing the Emperor instead, you're sort of giving Kalento either, you need to either push for lethal and try and kill me, but on zero cards, or you kind of have to kill Thorason, and if it kills Thorason, then
he's
again,
slowing down,
yeah,
right.
There's less damage, and it's only a matter of time. Look at the hand. A Life Coach can just use his Ancient of Law to draw two cards because he's still in good enough health to do that.
Yeah. I feel like Kalento pushing wouldn't surprise me one bit, especially with a hit of four.
Yeah, yeah. Right? I think with the four, you have to go face.
Now, suddenly you want to commit to that damage, and it's a good call because Life Coach may have to make the trades himself.
So, for Life Coach, it's pretty easy, right? Whatever was the outcome from the implosion, he still has to trade with this
exactly.
With the Nurban Egg spawn. So this doesn't make a difference. It just makes a difference that there are more minions on board that he can't really deal with. Right? Otherwise, the Keeper and Pink was pretty easy solution to the problem. In this situation, he has 9 mana, so he can't really do everything that he wants to, unless he will just double shade up Keeper Pink and leave 2 imps on board. And I'm thinking that's the best option.
Reduce the size of the board a little bit and also develop your own.
Yeah,
putting that many minions on the board is pretty big as well, because like you said, I know it's guaranteeing lethal next turn if he draws the Force of Nature.
Without options to use Darkness Aspirant instead of the pink, but I think like decreasing just the 1 damage when you're on 12, and you have the axe to heal next turn if you don't draw the Force of Nature.
The Aspirant.
Kind of.
That's all right, though. I mean, it's only 3 damage. That's 8, though. A tap into Power of Whelming would do it, right?
That does allow the Warlock to have one out. Not
one
thinking.
Power.
Yeah.
That's the only way.
And the problem as well is, does the Aspirant actually change anything next turn? What does it actually do?
Oh, my God. If Kalento will top deck the... If he will top deck the PO now...
The Aspirant didn't give him lethal with just Savage Roar either.
Not quite, but still, look at the damage output that Kalento's got this turn. Now he's playing around at least Savage Roar, if not combo. Mm-hmm. So based on that, his plays will have to be reevaluated.
So just the Savage Roar adds 10 damage.
One off.
So that's still... it's lethal, right?
It's lethal. It's got to be. It's got to be.
Yeah, that's,
he's got 18. Actually, yeah, you're right. It's one.
It's 2 off.
2 off lethal because he goes up to 19. So he might make a double trade here, but going face holds him safe against Savage Roar alone. He's dead to combo regardless, so he doesn't even play around it.
Oh, well, wait. 8-4.
Ancient of Lore, if another Innervate gets drawn,
I think it's
with the Force of Nature.
Okay. Or you can do that.
Well, the swipe was a perfect draw.
Yeah.
I mean, it was kind of hard for Life Coach to be pushed off of this.
It feels like Life Coach is out of the waters, right? Because there is no possibility of Kalento.
Yeah, that was a really big draw there. Again, he was open to the Power Overwhelming, though. That was pretty crazy.
Yeah, well, that was a huge match. All the uncertainty, right, till the last moment, because it felt like Kalento had the game in his grasp from the beginning.
Nonstop,
yeah.
Right.
He had really great outcomes from the draws, but the Dr. Boom Bomb.
That killed him, right. Yeah.
That was the huge thing that changed the game in favor for Life Coach. But still, he had one turn to top deck the PO to finish off with the perfect combo of Doomguard and +4 damage from the top of the deck, right?
I mean, he had a small chance up until the end, which is more than you can sometimes say when Druid ends up getting the board. So, Kalento feeling a bit under the weather. We saw him. I think he's feeling a little sick today.
But he played like very well, right? There was no difference in gameplay in his style when it comes to making decisions, and he played on top level, I think.
Yeah, and these two guys playing against each other, going to taking each game that far, not a surprise really when as top level as it's going to get for these two.
Yeah, that's true. Like this was the sixth match today.
Of the day, yeah. We have another three, I believe, right?
We have 10 matches in overall.
All right, so we got
still a lot of time here at Insomnia 56 Reserve Championship. So we will be having a short break. So don't go anywhere, and we're preparing the next match for you guys.